Now, he's been one of the most loyal Brexiters in Theresa May's cabinet, someone she can reliably send out to face the media after difficult weeks. And fair to say, they don't come much trickier than the week we've just had. So thank you, Liam Fox, for giving up your Sunday and for being here. I think it's worth just taking a step back for a moment. The government lost the vote on its Brexit deal by 149 votes last week. The only administration that has lost by a bigger margin than that is Ramsay MacDonald. You have to go back to 1924, and a few weeks later, of course, that administration collapsed. So do we actually have a functioning government right now?
We do, and there's been certainly movement towards the government's position. A lot of people are still considering what the events of last week tell us. What they tell me is that Parliament came within two votes of actually taking control of the agenda from the government. And if we don't get an agreement at this week's European Council and we don't get the support for the Prime Minister, chances are that that will be reversed and Parliament would take control. And about a year or so ago, after Chequers, I decided that there was a majority in the House of Commons against Brexit itself, and that unless we backed the agreement, however perfect or imperfect we thought it was, the chances were we wouldn't be able to deliver Brexit at all.
So I still have that. Parliament might be trying to stop Brexit.
Well, I think there are plenty in Parliament who would hold that back. Now, some of them do it for ideological reasons. Some of them are doing it for party political reasons. The Labour leadership come up with one ploy after another. You know, they wanted a referendum, then they didn't want a referendum, and then they wouldn't let their MPs vote for it. We need to end this because the voters, as you very clearly illustrated from Ipswich, have got Brexit fatigue. The public want us to get it done.
So, just to be crystal clear, because there has been some speculation in the newspapers this morning, is the vote on the Brexit deal going ahead next week? And do you think there's a chance it might pass?
Well, that will be determined, I think, by whether we can succeed in getting that vote through the House of Commons. There would be no point in having a vote if we'd no chance of winning that. Well, the aim will be, of course, to give the Prime Minister the backing. But that will be up for members of Parliament. And I would say to my colleagues, all actions have consequences. And if you really want to deliver the Brexit that we all promised, 80% of MPs in the current House of Commons stood on a manifesto that said, we will deliver on the manifesto. If we actually want to do that, then we need to back the Prime Minister's deal because there is no other deal on offer.
Just to be crystal clear on what you're saying, if the government thinks there's no chance of the vote passing next week, it might pull that vote.
Well, it would be difficult to justify having a vote if you knew we were going to lose it. But the aim will be to get the support behind the Prime Minister. If we can get that, if we can get to that European Council, then we can actually begin to make real progress. We can leave the European Union. There would probably have to be a short administrative delay of weeks to enable us to get the legislation through. But then we can actually start to do what the public, many of them think we have been doing, but unsuccessfully, which is to negotiate the next part of our agreement with the European Union, which is what is our trading relationship going to be with Europe? What is our security relationship with Europe going to be? These are the key elements that will determine Britain's future.
We saw in a series of extraordinary votes last week, you actually voted against your own government's motion on whether or not to delay Brexit. So why did you do that?
I think it was important to send a signal that we still wanted to be able to get an agreement and to leave on time. It may well be that the realities are that we can't get there now, but I have said time and time again...
You're sending a signal to your
that
Prime Minister
there as well. I wanted to ensure that we sent a signal to the voters that we wanted to honour our manifesto commitments.
I mean, are you worried about an extension? And how long an extension could you accept?
Well, if we had to have what I would call an administrative extension, because we got agreement at the European Council at the end of this week, and we required some time to get the necessary legislation through, I think that would be acceptable to most voters. They could see that this was a practical, pragmatic step that we had to take. If we had an extension with no agreement, and this was just kicking it into the long grass with the chance that Brexit might not happen at all, I think that would be very, very hard for most people to swallow.
I mean, Theresa May made it pretty clear in the House last week that if the deal doesn't get voted through, in the coming days, if you like, then we're looking at a long extension. We're looking at fighting those European Parliament elections. If that happens, could you stay in government?
Well, I think it would be really difficult for us to sell this to the British public.
But would you resign?
Well, as I said to you before, when people kept asking these questions, it's not about us, it's about the policy. It's about, could you actually justify saying to British voters, 3 years after they voted to leave the European Union, that they should take part in elections for a parliament that they don't want to have any part of. That's very, very difficult to do.
You see, you know, you voted against a long delay. You've just been explaining now why you think a long delay is something that's dangerous, that's a bad idea. I mean, I know we don't go in for collective responsibility anymore, but
well,
how could you
we
stay
do actually.
In,
well, actually,
stay in that?
Well, actually, that's where you're wrong, because I do think we have to have cabinet collective responsibility, and that's why we take the decisions, and that's why people don't threaten the Prime Minister with their resignation.
So would you resign then if there's a long delay?
As I said, it's not appropriate for cabinet ministers to threaten the Prime Minister with what they would do if they didn't get what they wanted. We take collective decisions together. Collective responsibility is the price you pay for having the privilege to sit in government.
So what do you make then of the fact that members of the cabinet abstained on a three-line whip last week?
Well, I think that, as I say, collective responsibility is the price we pay for having the privilege to sit around the cabinet table. And I hope that following the discussions we have, people will reflect on that, because we have to move forward. We cannot stay in the position we're in. We've been discussing the divorce from the EU, the withdrawal agreement, now for over 2 years. We need to move on to the next phase, which is how do we reset our relationship with Europe and with the rest of the world. That's what the whole Brexit debate needs to be about now.
Well, let's talk about that future relationship. When do you want to start negotiating new trade deals? That's your job, isn't it?
Well, it's part of. Actually, the biggest part of my job is to encourage British exports and investment, both of which, incidentally, are at record highs. Not that you would know that from watching some of our media or debates in Parliament. But we are not allowed, of course, to begin negotiations on new trade agreements between governments until after we leave the European Union, which is why it's very important that we get to that point. That point, we also begin our trade negotiations with the European Union itself to determine what our relationship would be at the end of any implementation period.
You also, of course, are trying to roll over existing trade deals to try and make sure that as many as possible are ready by the time we exit. I'll just have a quick look at something that you said back in 2017. I think we should be able to have a quick look at this. It's just being loaded up now. It's basically saying that, you know, I hear people saying, oh, we won't have any trade agreements before we leave. Well, believe me, we'll have up to 40 ready for 1 second after midnight in March 2019. All these faint hearts saying, cannot do it, it's absolute rubbish. We've finally got it up there. Apologies for that delay. So if we get
a deal, we will actually get all of those agreements rolled over. They will all happen if the Prime Minister's deal is accepted. That's one of the great bonuses that we get. It's one of the things that my colleagues in the House of Commons on both sides should be thinking about. If we want to get continuity in that, then the deal is on the table. They simply have to vote for it.
How many are ready to go now?
Well, a lot of them have been signed, and a number of them will be signed. And let me tell you where the delay comes. A lot of countries are very close to signing with us, but they're saying, well, we want to wait. We want to know whether you're actually going to stay in the European Union in the implementation period, where there will be an automatic rollover of these agreements, in which case we can start to think about the longer term, or we want to know if there's going to be no deal, in which case we'll have to come to a quick agreement to provide that continuity.
Now, I know you'll probably roll your eyes when I talk about the possibility of a general election, but it is something that people in Westminster are saying is an increasing possibility because of the deadlock that we see. So if there is an election this year, should Theresa May lead the Conservative Party in it?
Well, I think if we had an election this year, it would be because there was some kind of emergency situation. And of course, that would be thrust upon us at short notice. The Prime Minister has been very clear.
So it would be okay in that situation?
Well, she said that she wouldn't lead the party into the general election were it to be held in 2022. She's been very clear about that. I hope there won't be a general election this year. I hope we get, first of all, I think voters just don't want one. They want us to get on and govern. And this constant plea from Jeremy Corbyn that we must have a general election, we must have a general election. We're not going to. We need to continue government. We've got record employment in Britain. As I said, we've got record exports. We've had more quarters of consecutive growth than any other G7 country. This is a country that's doing extremely well, with wages rising much faster than prices now. We need to consolidate the gains that Conservative government has produced for Britain.
You see, I have to say that, you know, speaking to that Conservative Association in Ipswich, I mean, these are the guys who are knocking on the doors in a marginal seat. They are on the front line, if you like, of any election that could be fought. And they might be quite alarmed by the possibility of Theresa May leading the Conservative Party into that election, because they don't think she should. I can have a look at just a reminder of what two of those people, members of that Conservative Association, said. Mrs May has made a very poor job of the whole thing, the negotiating, and then In Fisher went on to say, we're the people that do the work and go knocking on the doors. If they're not listening to us, really that means they're not listening to the people either. They want a new generation to take over. I mean, are they right?
Well, they will get one, you know, in time. And we've got plenty of talented people who can lead the party. But look at the opinion polls at the present time. Conservatives are enjoying a good period in the opinion polls. We're enjoying good results at local government level at the present time.
Although some polls, one poll recently showed Labour overtaking the Conservatives, so they are mixed, aren't they?
Well, we've had, if you look at the average of recent polls, there's been a strong, very strong Conservative position. We've had leads up to 11 points in the polls. That's not the point, really. The point is that the policies that we're following are producing high levels of employment in this country, rising living standards, and the last thing we need to do is to gamble that on a hard left-wing Labour government, which I have to say, when I talk to overseas investors, they might be a little bit troubled by Brexit, but it's nothing to the fear that's engendered by the thought of a hard left-wing Labour government led by Jeremy Corbyn.
OK. Lynn Fox, thank you very much.
Thanks, Sophie.